just said, the signing of the chalice looks a lot like, basically like the same structure as we have for the sacrifice of the Mass, for the Alahoyo Corbona, with slight variations. The thing that we'll sing when we do the Psalm 51, which is on page 26 in his little booklet, is we'll use the same tone that we've been using in these past evenings. So we'll do the song now. Okay? Also for the sign of peace, you'll notice that the rubric is there, but not everyone reads the directive. So, on Good Friday, well, the sign of peace is normally much more silent than we do it, waving and doing these things. So normally it's just person to person with the hands folded. But on Good Friday, there's nothing said. You don't say peace to you, you say nothing. But the hands are folded and you bow to the person. You bow to the person who's next to you, who's giving, and you bow to the person beside you. So you just bow, there's no words. That's how the sign of peace is given on Good Friday. So when we come to the time, there's no movement from the altar. Because normally the sign of peace comes from the altar, through the ministers, to the congregation. All you'll have is a proclamation, let us now give the sign of peace to one another. And at that point, you just turn to the person next to you and bow. Turn to the other person on the other side of you and bow. It's quite beautiful. But it's the idea that because Judas betrayed our Lord with a kiss, there's no embrace, there's no contact, we don't wish peace, because peace is precisely what Judas used to betray our Lord on the night of his arrest. Alright? So we will begin then on what is noted as page 25 in this booklet. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord God, make us worthy to enter your house with diligence, to knock at your door with confidence, and to worship you in your sanctuary with sincerity. Answer us with your kindness, and respond to our petitions from the treasury of your mercy. Then we shall glorify you with joy, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your merciful love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me from the
sincerity of heart. In secret you teach me wisdom. Cleanse me with hyssop and I shall be pure. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
Create a pure heart for me, O Lord. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence.
Restore in me the joy of your salvation. Sustain in me a willing spirit. I will teach transgressors your ways, that sinners may return to you.
For the sacrifice you take no delight. Burnt offerings for me will not please you. My sacrifice to God.
Glory be to the Father, and to Let us raise glory, honor, and praise to the chalice of salvation which was filled on Golgotha. Sinners drank from it, and they were pardoned. With the blood of forgiveness that poured forth from the cross, all people were marked and escaped death. As this chalice, united to his holy body, will be blessed and consecrated for the pardon of faults and the forgiveness of sins of his blood, we raise glory and honor to the good one on this day and all the days of our lives and forever.
Scriptures. To you be glory forever.
angels? Host of angels stood in awe, and in fear beheld the sight. With great honor Joseph took our Lord's body from the cross.
Angels sang our Savior's praise as they stood around his tomb. People of the earth proclaimed, Lord, you saved us by your death.
Great Friday crucifixion, a reading proclaimed. So strengthen your drooping hands and your weak knees. Make straight paths for your feet, that what is lame may be dislocated, but healed. Not dislocated, but healed. Strive for peace with everyone, and for that holiness without which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one be deprived of the grace of God, that no bitter roots spring up and cause trouble, through which many may become defiled, that no one be an immortal or profane person like a soul, who sold his birthright for a single meal. For you know that later, when he wanted to inherit his father's blessing, he was rejected because he found no opportunity to change his mind, even though he sought blessings with tears. You have not approached that which could be touched, and a blazing fire, which, and gloomy darkness, and storm, and a trumpet blast, and a voice speaking words, such that those who heard begged that no message be further addressed to them. For they could not bear to hear the command, even if an animal touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so fearful was the spectacle that Moses said, I am terrified and trembling.
Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies to be left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and they broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you may also believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occur so that the scripture might be fulfilled, none of his bones shall be broken. And again another passage of scripture says, they shall look upon the one whom they have pierced. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Of course, on this day, what we commemorate is our Lord's going to the cross at midday. The transference of the Blessed Sacrament from the chapel where it's reposed since last night, we will come out the side wall and come down the center aisle. What you'll notice that's significant about this ceremony is that calling the sign of the chalice, we have on the preparatory altar, you notice on the side, just the chalice in which there is water and wine as usually prepared, but with just the small pall on top of it. It will be brought over after a long acclamation, diaconal acclamation, be brought over to the altar. Then when we wind up bringing the Blessed Sacrament in, the signing of the chalice is the uniting of our Lord's consecrated body from last night, the Last Supper, with the blood which is shed on Calvary, represented by simply the wine. But you'll notice it in the prayers indicate communicate to the other places and to this conjoining, even though there are no words of institution as we're used to at a Mass. But there is a transformation that takes place of this wine into our Lord's precious blood. The signing, the commingling. Mingling is precisely in the Syriac tradition the idea of how we are transformed by grace. Last night we spoke about our Lord being the medicine of God, tree of life. And that reality of our Lord is present in the Holy Eucharist. That reality is because of the mingling, which is why we chose the anaphora of St. John Chrysostom last night. Because on a couple of occasions we have the prayers. That the mingling of your body with our bodies and your blood with our souls, that we be transformed. In the Greek tradition, they use the term theosis, literally divinization. There is, to some extent, also in the Latin tradition, that idea. But the East is especially strong on the idea of the medicinal transformation of us in healing. And so when we bring this sacred body of the medicine of God, which is our divine Lord, body, blood, soul, and divinity, really, truly, and substantially present, under the appearances, and only the appearances of bread, that transformation in presence is that mingling that we receive in Holy Communion, that we ourselves be medicinally healed. So this evening, when we talk about the death of our Lord on Calvary, we'll talk about a different aspect of the living veil. But it's an important thing when we think about St. Paul, when he writes to the Romans in chapter 5, and it's a reading that we use for the morning office on Good Friday. St. Paul, when he writes to the Romans, he says, it would be difficult for us to find someone who would die for another person who was good. We have examples of it. We have an example recently in southern France of the policeman who exchanged himself for the hostage and wound up being put to death. He wound up being killed because of this. But he knew that he was sacrificing his life for this other person that he didn't know. And so St. Paul uses something along these same examples. It's rare, we celebrate it, it's so rare, that someone would give their life for another person, but a person who's good. And he says, so how much more is the death of our Lord when he died for us when we were his enemies? We were not his friends when he died on Calvary. It is precisely this reconciliation of the human race with God that our Lord's charity, this divine love, desires to bring about. So St. Paul says that the sense that we are to appreciate the fact is that the human race, we were not friends of this man who died for us. And so if we are redeemed, if we are purchased, and the notion of redeeming in the Syriac tradition, or the Semitic tradition, is Gaol. And Gaol was a person within the family. So this notion of family, and usually it's the patriarch, Jiddu, who has the responsibility to protect everyone in his extended family. And if you have a younger brother or a cousin who's an idiot and winds up kind of, all of his money disappears and his children are now going to be hungry, you have to get him back from that bad situation. I mean, you might beat him up later on. But Gaol, the Redeemer, you have that responsibility to protect if they were taken away, well, especially in the old days, carried off as slaves during some military campaign. You bought them back. You've got the money together to buy your stupid younger brother back. So the notion of redemption is that there is a protection and a family aspect that everyone is meant to be kept within the family and kept healthy. The redemption is not our Lord paid some kind of a fine. And that gives us, as we mentioned last night, tickets to go somewhere. It's a family which he constitutes around him, which was constituted in paradise, which we decided we didn't want. And like the prodigal son we went stomping off, making up our own decisions as to how we thought things should be. And that clash throughout the generations and the centuries is what caused that enmity. That is not the family that God created. So in this, when our Lord says that the Son of Man has come not to serve, to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many, he's saying, I have come to purchase you back from your stupid gambling habits. I've come to purchase you back from your sensuality which plunges you in the gutter. I have come to redeem you from those things which have oppressed and enslaved you, which is why he says in the gospel, that by which we sin, we are servants to. That is the notion of redemption. To buy us back because we've wandered off and brought ourselves into hostages and as slaves of ultimately stupidity, our sins, our selfishness, our sensuality, our avarice, our anger. These things are what our Lord came to bring us back from. So when St. Paul writes in the letter to the Romans in chapter 5, and he says, you know, think about this. The day that he died on Calvary, no one was his friend, except the Mother of God. As I mentioned the other night, she's the only one for whom the faith remained burning. The lamp remained lit. Mary Magdalene is there, it is true. John is there, true. And there are a few others that are also there. They are there from the affection, which is good, but it's not supernatural. They do not believe in the resurrection. They do not expect to see him rise in glory, which is why they all show up at the tomb 3 days later. They do not expect it. They're only there from sentiment and affection, which is good, but not enough. And so even there, they have tripped up. The only one who stands at this cross, who loves supernaturally, who has retained her loyalty, her fidelity, her belief in this victorious ransom being given here, is one person, the Mother of God, Mary of Nazareth. That's it. One person of the entire human race. Which is why the Blessed Virgin Mary is referred to as the daughter of Zion. These prophecies in the Old Testament about Jerusalem, Zion, to rise up and to receive it through Messiah, to rejoice. We heard it on Shanim. To rejoice from the prophet Zechariah that your Savior comes to you seated upon a donkey. She is the one who embodies the reality of the fidelity of the city of God, of Jerusalem. She is the one who stands at the foot of the cross, always believing, but also because of the sensitivity of her mind, her soul, her heart, the anguish that she suffered was all the more profound. It is sad enough if you were to consider any mother losing her child to an injustice and being publicly humiliated in this way. But it is the sensitivity and the sinlessness of her soul which makes this pain all the more profound. You think about when our children are little and they're talking to us, when we're busy making dinner. We hear them, we're not ignoring them, but we're distracted. So we hear, it doesn't matter, she's only four, right? So we're distracted with other things. So we're not really listening fully attentively. And we rarely ever listen fully attentively to anyone in any case, because we're distracted. But if you have the soul of perfect and sheer lucidity and sinlessness in which the mind in its clarity focused upon God and is transformed by grace, everything that is heard, sensed, experienced, thought on, meditated on, prayed on, has all the more profound reality of having that receptivity. That is what happens with our Lord and our Lady during these 3 days. While all of us can be sympathetic to a level of being betrayed by your most intimate friends, and may have even had the experience of having that done to us, none of us can really understand the degree of how profound the essentially loving heart of God incarnate, of what that betrayal meant to him. All the more profound in this reality taking place, and therefore in the sinlessness of the Mother of God as she stood there, she is the great consolation to our Lord, if there is any on Calvary. But when St. Paul says that if this has been the ransom given to us and we are reconciled through his death, then how much more by his life? That resurrection and that triumph also is what brings the light and the glory into our lives. So what we contemplate this morning, this early afternoon, is the beginning of the whole route of Calvary. The weights placed upon our Lord, the humiliation, the jeering, the mockery, and also the fact that he suffers by the fact of what his mother has to undergo. Oh, you know that in the Talmud, the Blessed Virgin Mary is obviously not referred to as the Blessed Virgin Mary in the Talmud. She's portrayed as being some bimbo hairdresser who happened to shack up at one point with some Roman soldier. That's where Jesus came from. That's the portrayal by the Pharisees to this day of who this woman was. And I only bring it out today because that's one statement written that's been there for centuries. But to think on that day, especially for those who know the intimacy in a Middle Eastern culture between mothers and their sons and sons and their mothers, of how much pain he had by hearing the jeers in the crowd, not just mocking him as being a false Messiah, but what he hears, the blasphemies against his mother in this crowd. Because she's there the whole time. These are the things that we contemplate in this early afternoon leading up to our Lord's death. And tonight, we'll come back to that moment of death as we do the death and burial of our Lord. May that Mother of God, in her purity of soul and of that heart that was pierced by a sword, and as Simeon said decades before when our Lord was a baby, your soul, your heart shall be pierced so that many thoughts may be revealed. Kind of mysterious. But our reaction to this moment of our Lord's passion and death reveals who we truly are as individuals. Your soul shall be pierced so that the thoughts of many will be revealed. You're here today. You're not at the mall. You're not out doing whatever, planning for just some frivolous weekend. That is a gift that our Lord has touched our hearts, given us the ability to see, however much we think we live, to see this mystery. And for that, as St. Paul says, when we've appreciated what it meant that our Lord ransomed me, I am the stupid little brother. I'm the idiot who's gambled away my children's goods. When I realize that, my heart has nothing to do but then to swell with gratitude and thanksgiving for this great sacrifice. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. This is the chalice of salvation, God's life-giving blood. Come forward for all peoples and rejoice, for it absolves those who partake of it. This is the chalice which satisfies the thirst of man's race. Those who drink from it are delivered from the flames of Gehenna. The chosen nation prefigured this chalice, but we came in person, other nations instead. Welcomed him with joy. The honorable priest Aaron prefigured this chalice when he sprinkled the blood of birds to signify the blood of the Lord. The prophet Moses prefigured this chalice by the last blood, which he sprinkled in Egypt to deliver the children of Israel. The Lord reigns and is clothed in majesty. Praise the Lord. Our Lord's side was pierced on the cross. Blood and water flowed from it to pardon creation. The faithful church approaches with open hands to receive the blood and life-giving water, which are two reliable witnesses to the divinity and humanity of the Virgin Son on the cross. Alleluia. Consecrate this chalice for us.
On the cross, the side of Christ was pierced and wounded. Blood and water flowed from him to pardon all sins. O faithful church, now draw near to him with open hands to receive these gifts. Blood and water witnesses the truth of Jesus, that he is true God and man. This chalice blesses the Lord.
Spirit now, always and forever.
Amen. His entire history.
protection before your awesome throne. Make us worthy to spend all the days of our lives without confusion and distress, but in doing good according to your will. For this reason we petition you and glorify you, O God, our Father, only Son, Savior of all, and living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
We pray and we beseech you, O Lord God, in this solemn and holy moment, for our fathers who lead us in this life, and for those who govern the Church, Francis the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter our Patriarch, Gregory John our Bishop, together with all bishops, let us pray to the Lord.
Sisters who have asked us, weak though we are, to pray for them. Remember those who are subject to difficulties and who take refuge in you. Visit and deliver them. We pray for this place which God guards, and for the peace and spiritual growth of those who live here, that they may live in prosperity. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember all true Christian leaders who have built churches, monasteries, and convents in all parts of the world. We pray for all Christians in their public activities and services, the clergy and all the faithful, that they may lead holy lives. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We remember the Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, remember the prophets, apostles, evangelists, disciples, martyrs and confessors, John the Baptist, the messenger and forerunner of the Savior, Stephen, the archdeacon and forerunner, and all the saints. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember those who have died and are among the saints, especially those who have preserved and given us this apostolic faith. We proclaim the four holy ecumenical councils of Nicaea, Constantinople, Ephesus, and Chalcedon. We remember our glorious fathers and faithful doctors of the Church who dwell with God, St. James, brother of the Lord and illustrious apostle, martyr and bishop, Ignatius, Dionysius, Athanasius, Basil, Gregory, Timothy, Euthynias, John, and especially Cyril, the Tower of Truth, the Chosen of God, St. Maron, our Blessed Father, St. James and St. Ephraim, both pillars of our Holy Church, and for all those who kept the true faith and passed it on to us, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
church proclaims, receive the body of the Son, drink his blood, and sing his praise. This is the chalice that our Lord makes on the cross. From those, O mortals, who drink from it for the pardon of your faults.
Oh, bread of life.
the side of the Father, Son, and the living Lord God. From his side, he opens the cross by the Mass, our thirst is satisfied. Behold, the Church tells the priest to carry it above the altar for the pardon of her children. Behold, the Holy Chalice, from it receive salvation. From it we drink and are made worthy of the pardon of our faults. Behold, today is accomplished in the ministry of true priests, that all nations are saved. Behold the chalice of King David foretold, stating, I will receive the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Behold, today it is completed on the table of life, that mortals are promised eternal life. We have united, O Lord, your divinity with our humanity, and our humanity with your divinity.
Having been delivered from death, let us dwell in your light with all the saints.
raise glory to the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your head before the Lord.
O Lord, we bow our heads before you, before your forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We worship the glorious Trinity. We ask that you would raise love, compassion, and mercy, the compassion and the forgiveness of our sins. Hear our prayers and be attentive to our petitions. Answer our requests from the abundant treasury of your mercy. Make us worthy to come forward in all purity and holiness, to receive the body and blood of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We shall praise the glorious Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask Him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts to the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord. For he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by thy holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our community be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
It's not
Give you thanks, O living Lamb of God. You came down to heaven, clothed yourself in the body of our humanity, and died for the life and salvation of all people. Prophets and kings yearned to see you, but were unable. Yet you let us, weak sinners, hold you in our hands and be purified by you. We give you praise for your awesome majesty and your grace toward us. You are the burning fire touched by our fingers, and the living ember kissed by our lips. Purify, O Lord, the mouths, lips, and hands of those who held your body. Sanctify the bodies, the souls, and minds of those who have received your blood. Cleanse their hearts, consciences, spirits, and all their senses. Mark them with the seal of your cross, and place within them your hidden power. O Lord our God, glory to you, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
May God bless, sanctify us all, and protect the faithful who have participated in this divine service of mysteries. May he grant forgiveness to their brothers and sisters and to the departed. And may he save us from confusion and shame before him on the day of judgment forever and ever.